So here's financial globalization. Financial globalization makes us very uncomfortable. The idea that sort of the market and finance is global and we are local. We are really, really small. We're a lot smaller today than we were 50 years ago relative to the markets we're dealing with. This is true of central banks as well. Central banks feel, you know, that maybe the market is bigger than me, okay? And what can I do when I'm faced with Goldman Sachs, or which is a global firm with its tentacles everywhere? You know, all I have is my little bilateral swap line, you know, with the Fed, you know, or even not with the Fed. Here's a vision that I have found helpful when I have this nightmare. Okay, this is a paper that Charlie Kuhlberger wrote with two other fellows, Emile Dupre and Walter Salant, in 1966. Very short paper, was published in The Economist. This was when the Bretton Woods arrangement was coming under some stress, and people were saying, oh, the dollar's weak. There was this thing called the Tripping Dilemma people were anxious about. And Kindleberger said, this is just, you need to not worry about this, okay? And have a vision of a possible future, which he described here. And I'll just read, this is the little two paragraphs I pulled out there. He argues here, an effective, smoothly functioning international capital market is itself an instrument of world economic growth. Okay, so he's saying short-term free capital movements are good for growth, at least potentially. Not a nuisance which can be disposed of, but a function which can be transferred to new or expanded intergovernmental institutions. He's talking there about the IMF, he's talking about the SDR. Okay, the notion that you don't have to have private capital markets, you could do this in an intergovernmental kind of way. The main requirement of international monetary reform is to preserve and improve the efficiency of private capital market while building protection against its performing in a destabilizing fashion. This is the inherent instability of credit that he's referring to here, the destabilizing fashion. Managing that, not eliminating the private and going with the public, not eliminating the public and going with the private. He's not an Austrian, right? He's saying we need to manage this. This is the system that we're living in. This is the system we need to manage. And that's true, even more true today than it was in 1966. He was seeing the future. And he would be quite amazed at how things have developed since then. But it's our problem, too. And economics is not a help. The focus of economics, the ideology of economics, that, well, we're going to be experts, okay? We're going to be scientists. That technocratic language obscures the politics, that somehow we know something about how the economy works, and so we can intervene to stabilize business cycles, to reduce inflation in a kind of technocratic way, okay? That is neutral politically. That's how it's all displayed. But once you take on board all of those five things that I just mentioned to you, it seems quite that you're not telling the truth. You know, there are features of what you're doing that are inherently political. Academic debate is even more frustrating. Okay, that it, you know, there's these models. Okay, mathematical models. We tell students, if you master this model, you will have some knowledge about the world. And so generations of students think, I don't need to know about the world, I just need to know how the models work. Okay? But the models abstract from money, they abstract from central banking. And this has been true for the post-war period almost entirely. You know, this argument between Keynesians and monetarists, ISLM versus the quantitative theory, you know, neither one of those has a central bank, has this hierarchical structure that I was talking about. They're just talking money supply, money demand, and there's an interest rate that either does set the interest, either clears the money market or makes saving equal to investment and full employment, or, you know, those are the kinds of models that we're teaching students, and then they try to read the newspaper and they try to understand the world around them, and it doesn't really link up. Active management versus laissez-faire is a more recent version of this. A lot of this is about whether you believe in equilibrium or not. The new synthesis and the great moderation. This is the history of these debates in macroeconomics, which, from the point of view of these five points, seems sort of not focusing on the main issues. This is the kind of hollowed out this political discussion that happens in economics. But I think that's changing. And it's changing because it has to change. It's changing because of the financial crisis. This is the financial crisis from the point of view of somebody from New York City. This is the balance sheet of the Fed as it happened. If you've read my book, New Lombard Street, you have seen this there. I wanted them to put it on the cover, but I thought it would scare people, or scare people because it looks too technical or something. I don't know. I think it's just beautiful. But it shows you that what the Fed did, it shows you that before Bear Stearns and then Lehman AIG, the Fed was just lowering interest rates using Fed funds rate to try to stay, and it didn't work. Okay. After Bear Stearns, they lent out half of the balance sheet, okay, liquidated their treasury bills and lent it to brokers and dealers, and that didn't work. Okay. And after AIG and Lehman, they expanded the balance sheet on both sides. This alchemy of banking, okay, is now here in full force. Okay. And this particular thing here, this is the swap line with other central banks. That's $600 billion that was created. So this is an enormous change in the central banks doing things they swore up and down they'd be able to do, and they did them. And it worked, okay, after a fashion, meaning that it stopped the bleeding, it stopped the crisis. And now what? Okay. So there's a lot of desire, of course, to go back to normal. You know, can we just run this tape in reverse? You know, exit strategy. There's a lot of difficulty in doing that. I think this is a sea change, and it's a new world that we need to learn to manage. And it's a sea change not just for individual central banks. I say it's not just a gadget moment, okay, in terms of a sea change in how we think of the role of central banks, but it's a Bretton Woods moment because it's an international. This was a global crisis because it was a crisis of the dollar funding system. And this is my chart to illustrate that. This is the spread between the euro-dollar rate, or LIBOR, as it was called, and the term Fed funds rate, or the overnight index swap. At 1 month and at 3 months. So these are both promises to pay dollars, okay, in 1 month or in 3 months. They're both promises by banks. Okay. Shouldn't they have the same interest rate? Shouldn't this spread be zero? Okay. This spread was zero until the crisis started, or 2 or 3 basis points. Okay. And then it went to 100 basis points. This is 1%. And then Bear Stearns, it seems to have stabilized and went to 300 basis points. So this is about the near breakdown of the par relations between the international dollar, the euro dollar, the private dollar, and the domestic dollar, okay? The US dollar, the liability of the Fed. Okay? And it almost broke that par relation. And I mean this very precisely. If you saw interest rates in Mexico being 3 percentage points higher than interest rates in the United States, you would say to yourself, oh, I see. The Central Bank of Mexico is defending their exchange rate against the dollar, and they're having to pay up. They're having to pay an extra 3% to keep people in pesos instead of in dollars. Well, that's exactly what was happening here. Okay? The international dollar had to pay up an extra 3 percentage points, okay, in order to keep people there instead of flying to the shores of the United States. The international reserve function of the dollar was in threat there until the Fed said, okay, we will be lender of last resort to the world system. And that's what that central bank swap was about. This is huge. This is a big change. When Charlie Kimberger was saying those words in 66, there was a lot of anxiety in the U.S. about, we don't want to have the Fed be the world central bank. We do not want world money markets in New York. We want to get them out of the United States. And so they did go out of the United States. They went to London. This is the beginning of the euro dollar market. And Americans fooled themselves to say, oh, offshore, not my problem, okay? This is the Bank of England's problem or somebody else, okay? Not true.
not true, as we discovered in this crisis. The Fed was forced to backstop world money markets, and that then worked. It didn't work until they had backstopped world money markets by doing these liquidity swaps with other central banks. So we're in a, so the, both of these I'm meaning to show, to tell you, we've been through a sea change, okay? We've been through a big shock. And the intellectual apparatus that we had available to us was, it was shown to be not adequate to the task, okay? So there's a task of some new economic thinking. The politics is getting in the way, though. And a lot of the politics is getting in the way because people don't even understand what happened and why it happened. And, you know, was this about the Fed bailing out Wall Street? If so, they're all evil and we should send them to jail. Or was this about the Fed monetizing government debt? Is that what QE is? Okay, big government, you know, we need to stop them from doing that. And, you know, there's a lot of anxiety about this. And economists are not serving the role of educators in helping people understand what happened. Here's the piece that really freaks people out about financial globalization. The other piece, so this crisis, I would say, it's a sea change. What it was the first crisis of the new market-based credit system. The first, not the last, okay? We're gonna have more. This is the way the system works now. There was a lot of belief that if we move credit from banking into capital markets, we'll be making it more stable. That there was something about fractional reserve banking or something. That's where the instability came from. And if we move it into capital markets, it'll all be fine. It's big boys. It's Wall Street talking to pension funds. They're big boys, and it's going to be fine. Well, it was not fine. It was not fine. Here's what shadow banking is, according to me. I define shadow banking as money market funding of capital market lending. And that's what this is here. It's capital funding bank. Is money market funding of residential mortgage-backed securities, RMBS. These were the kinds of arrangements that got into trouble, okay, in the crisis. And I'm showing this bank, this capital funding bank, as holding these securities and then stripping out all the risks, with a credit default swap, with an interest rate swap, with a foreign exchange swap, if these things are not dollar denominated, and selling those through a derivative dealer to some asset manager that is taking those exposures as a way of making money. And then funding the result, which is a kind of quasi-treasury bill, you strip out all the risk, okay, in world money markets by borrowing from global money dealers, repo markets, asset-backed commercial paper, and so forth. So the key players in the modern system are not so much the bank here, but these dealers, because that's where prices come from. This is where the price of funding comes from, okay? The interest rate on 1 and 3 month funding, okay? This is where the price of risk comes from. The risk of default, the duration risk, foreign exchange risk. These are where those prices come from. Add up all those prices and you get the price of the residential mortgage-backed security. So it's these dealers that are key for understanding where this inherent instability comes from in the modern system. And backstopping them, making them more robust, is the secret to making the system more stable. Backstopping means making them have more capital so that they can take losses, okay, without collapsing, but also having reserves so that if they have liquidity flight, they can use those reserves as the first resort. And here are two for the derivative dealers, but also backstopping by the central bank. That's what these liquidity puts here. Okay. If the first resort doesn't work, the last resort has to work. And so now I just put these two dealers here and put the central bank or the C6, okay, the group of central banks, which is basically the last resort behind this dealer system. So this is what I'm telling you. This is the emerging system that we have to make work somehow. But think about this is a very different kind of role for central bank. You know, that the image we have of a central bank is sort of, well, I'm moving the Fed funds rate or some policy rate by 50 basis points in order to stabilize inflation or something. This, you're doing what? You're backstopping these dealers? That's Credit Suisse. You know, this isn't what we signed up for, you know, as a democratic people. This is the system that is evolving, and the one that we need to find a way
to feel comfortable with. A lot of that is about finding a way to price these things so that the government's not getting whipped off, so that you're not creating incentives. You know, because of course, if you backstop somebody, they say, you know, if you're going to pay, if you get the downside and I get the upside, I'm going to take way, way more risk. Right? Moral hazard. We're economists. We know about that. So this is the anxiety we have about this. On the other hand, if you don't backstop them, you know, it's inherent instability and it's just going to collapse. So this is the problem we've had ever since Badgett, and we know about this problem, but this is a new form of the problem, okay, that we don't know about, and we have to wrap our arms around it. Badgett thought the way around this was lend free at a high interest rate. Okay? That was his idea. But if you just make it expensive, then you can sort of chase away people who are looking for cheap money. And so I think you need to do that here. You need to make this liquidity insurance expensive. Now I come to the new politics. And now here, this is just suggestive, but maybe we'll have some discussion about this, because I'm still thinking about this. Most of this stuff before, although it might sound crazy, I feel pretty sure about it. I've thought about this for a long time. Here I feel like I'm on a little new ground here. So the new politics, this dealer of last resort already creates new product. You know, during the crisis, when the Fed intervened to expand its balance sheet, it was using the techniques of war finance. It was using, this is what central banks looked like during World War I, you know, or World War II. They all took on government debt on their balance sheet. They blew up three times. This is exactly what happened in central banks in war. We had a war here, okay? But it was a private war. It was private finance that got bailed out, not the government, okay? It was private financial assets that showed up. And this is waving red flag, okay, to people who are anxious about, is this government, is this central bank a creature of government, or is it a creature of Wall Street, or who owns it? Who owns it? You can look on their balance sheet and you get anxious about that. So this is already there. Then after the crisis was over, what did they do? They did QE. You know, they bought more financial assets. In fact, in the United States, there's a talk about deliberately distorting asset prices, making asset prices too high. Okay? So there's distributional consequences of this, that people who own these assets are being bailed out, apparently, okay? And the people who owe are not. This is what monetary policy is doing on purpose to try to create economic stimulus. This is the Bernanke and Yellen sort of plan. Using again the public balance sheet or this quasi-public balance sheet, like Fed. Behind the scenes, so much behind the scenes that most people haven't even noticed it, there's also been this integration of central banks into this net, this C6 Times, a year ago, and covered, as far as I know, nowhere else in the standard press to be aware of that. That what is the organization that is sort of running the world economy now is this loose coalition of central bankers. I always put on my slides now, forget the G7, watch the C6. Or now there's all this debate, forget the G7, we should go for the G20 or the G100 or something. Most of this is a silo, okay? What is keeping the system together at the moment is this very undemocratic operation of central banks talking with each other. And thank God they are. I mean, thank God somebody's working together, because certainly the G7 aren't talking to each other, and the G20 aren't talking to each other. So some of this is about central banks taking on new tasks because no one else is doing it. Okay? They didn't want to do this. They felt obliged to do this. And if we can sort out the politics and get the finance ministers of the world to actually do business with each other, I think central bankers would be happy about that. But that seems a dream at the moment. I'm going to talk about the center and the periphery moving from. This was another big change. And I'll say something about it. This is an undeveloped part. I'm thinking, what do I have to say to people in Argentina? Okay, I'm talking about. They're from New York. So I'm sorry. That's periphery. That refers to you here. Okay, fine. So I'm not offending you. I stand corrected. Yes. Okay.
Here.
Yes. Here. Okay. So I will build out this part. I you're going to help me do this. Okay. From the as you know, then
that sort of after the Asian financial crises, a lot of central banks in the periphery said, this is not going to happen to us, the tender mercies of the IMF. We're going to accumulate reserves. But in the financial crisis, what happened? They didn't pay down those reserves, okay? They borrowed. They got swap lines, emergency swap lines, with Brazil, with the Fed, and Mexico, and others with from other institutions. So this whole system of network of how the central banks are linked together is shifting toward these network of bilateral swap lines that are being put in place. Not just at the top, I talked about the C6, these swap lines that link the SIC, but this whole network of bilateral swap lines. China has sort of been a big leader there. They don't have a swap with anybody. You know, they have with you and with everybody. And some of this is just for show, but some of it is real, okay? And it is developing into the network of the developing international backstop of the financial system. The challenge we're facing, and not just in the United States, but here too, is the transition to markets. From a world in which the central bank is most of the story, okay, which is what happens in the financial crisis, and what has happened after the financial crisis because of QE and so forth, to a world where actually there are markets, and people are taking risks, and they're lending, they're borrowing. We're going from war time to peacetime. I told you that the financial crisis was like war finance. The transition from war finance to peace finance is not easy. This history tells us, okay? In the United States, it took about a decade, actually. And the Fed Treasury Accord, 1952, okay? And as capital markets start to get built up, it's gonna be even more fraught with trouble here. The Fed at least didn't have to worry about there's all this existing capital market infrastructure. There wasn't. It was all destroyed by the Depression. So they were building from new. But here, we're trying to get back to normal, and all this structure is there. And it's going to start trading or not. Here's my guess about what seems to be evolving, okay? Which is that this dealer infrastructure that I showed you is sitting in the center of this market-based credit system. This dealer infrastructure is splitting into two pieces. There's a matched book piece, okay, which is matched book just means that you have equal and opposite exposures on both your liability and your asset side. So that if prices move, you're hedged. It's a perfect hedge. Matched book dealers are exposed to liquidity problems if the person doesn't pay you on time, but they're not exposed to price risk. So their problem is liquidity, so they are going to be backstopped by this network of world central banks in the first, but we want to make them backstop themselves first. So private first resort, public last resort. This is in the very infancy stages of being put together, but the pressure to put all these derivatives on exchanges and put them on central clearing counterparties is going to lead us in that direction. The speculative book, the actual market making, where people are not having match book, they're taking positions, they're taking price risk, is staying inside some. So this all stuff used to be on the balance sheet of these big investment banks. And now it's become too expensive for them, and it's being pushed onto the center. So they're all shrinking their matched book. But they're still doing this, the speculative book. This requires capital. Again, private first resort, public last resort. Fraught politics of stabilization involve, we're trying to divide, if you will, this liquidity problem from the solvency problem. Okay? And therefore, the backstop. The liquidity problem is inherently global, and it's going to be backstopped by the central bank network, the C6 ultimately at the top. Okay. Whereas the capital backstop is inherently local, solvency. And the problem is you can't really, in a crisis, it's hard to distinguish whether it is a liquidity problem or a solvency problem. Liquidity problems can cause prices to move and cause insolvency all the time. And so then there's a debate, who's supposed to pay here? Okay, is this something for the world central banking operation, or for local treasurers, it's political. The transition to markets is not going to be easy. Maybe in the interest of time, I'll skip this. What would exit mean? This is about the Fed getting out of the business of fixing asset prices.
and getting to what would monetary policy look like in a future regime. This is the part that's going to interest you, which is international differentiation, because the Bank of Argentina is not the Fed. The important thing to appreciate is that this hierarchy of this international monetary system hierarchy that I was talking about is also a involves central banks that have very different characters in terms of their balance between government bank and bankers bank. And also exchange rate regimes, right? Fixed exchange rate regimes, flexible, managed, you know, there's a spectrum here. A lot of that spectrum is about whether the central bank is mostly a government bank. That is to say, the market making in your foreign exchange, is this, are there deep and liquid private markets that are doing this? If not, it's the central bank that is doing this. And also domestically, for lending. How important is the central bank for lending? Is there, in fact, a deep and liquid credit market in your country? And it varies a lot by nations. So the story about the role of central banks and the politics of central banks is going to be different in different countries. Precisely because of their different levels of financial development, and also because of the different places that they hook into this international hierarchy, this international hierarchy of money. The C6 swap lines at the top seem to me to hold the promise for a kind of flexible coordination at the top, that they allow exchange rate, it's not a fixed exchange rate system between the C6, you're allowing those exchange rates to move, to take up some of the slack, to absorb some of the instability, and you're trying to backstop them, that they don't become too volatile. They don't hop around. You know, they can move. They can move. They're not frozen. But like par between private money and public money, between currency and bank deposits, that's frozen at one. It takes a lot of apparatus to keep that price there. The same for fixed exchange rates. It takes a lot of apparatus to keep that fixed price there. So I think there's going to be some flexibility there. Everyone else is hooking into this system in different ways. The emerging markets, what's particularly interesting that's happening recently, is the way that private firms in Argentina, Brazil, okay, are tapping global markets for their domestic finance. So they're tapping into this money market funding of capital market lending as a source of their own private credit, expecting to be backstopped by some local operation, okay, that remains to be built. Central banks, therefore, from this point of view, are operating necessarily as the foreign exchange market maker, or at least the backstop of the foreign exchange market. This puts them right in at the boundary between public and private, I talked about that before, but also between national and global. Now I have a picture about that maybe I can come back to that. Here's my picture. This is from a recent paper, working paper in the Bank for International Settlements. I always tell my students, if you read the Financial Times, okay, and the working papers of the Bank of International Settlements, you're done. We are in an age of information overload, okay? And most of it is not information, it's noise, okay? But if you want information, okay, that's what you want to be reading. These are serious advice. And it is advice that I take to heart. I read these things, okay? And I do not read other things, okay? Because it's noise. It bothers me, and it distracts me from what's happening. So here's a picture, and it's showing Company A's is issuing a bond to global investors. So this is what I mean by the capital markets. Global capital markets are creating opportunities for domestic firms in places like Argentina to issue bonds that are being grabbed up by some pension fund somewhere. Okay? And then what do they do with the proceeds? In this paper, Shin, who's the new research director of the BIS, has sort of trying to track this empirically. What do they do with it? One thing they do with it is they can lend it downstream onshore. So this shows the capital inflow, okay, into Argentina, and to fund their own operation. They could use it to fund other companies, trade credit, and loans to other companies in the same industry or suppliers or something like that. They could deposit it in banks and use it as liquidity reserves. So this is where
this global market-based credit system is connecting up with this local, you know, trade credit, traditional banking, and that seems to Shin, and I think he's right about that, that this is the place you want to watch for building tensions and fragility in the system. I guess I put these slides in the wrong order. This is referring to the Global Financial Stability Report, which is the IMF report. Normally, I would say not necessary reading, okay? But this one is, okay? And this was Christine Lagarde gave a speech at a recent IMF conference in which she pulled out three bullet points from that were minor in the report, but she made them the essence of the report, and this is important. If the director is saying these are the essence of the report, then they are the essence of the report. That she said, we are facing a time today where we're shifting from bank credit to non-bank credit, market-based credit. This I've been telling you. So the IMF is now telling you this too. We're moving from a time where our concerns are not sovereign credit anymore, not the peripheral debt in Europe and so forth, but non-sovereign credit. She's talking about exactly this kind of thing that I was talking, just showing you here about domestic firms issuing bonds abroad, in foreign currencies possibly too, okay? And that means that our concern has to shift from being about bank solvency. This is what everything was about after the crisis. How do we get more capital into the banks? Bank solvency. And they're realizing, we did all of that, and what did it do for us? It gave us banks that don't make loans that are very safe. And all the loan lending is happening in the non-bank sector, and we haven't even really thought about how that worked. So market liquidity becomes the focus now of thinking about how do we backstop the system, how do we keep its inherent tendency to instability under control. That requires us, now these are my bullet points, okay, to attend to the economics of the dealer function and to the economics of the dealer of last resort function. This is where market liquidity comes from. These are the institutions that are at the core of the new market-based credit system. There's a lot of economics to be done in figuring out how to make them more robust, how to make them work better. But there's a lot of politics as well in order to implement that. People need to understand it. They need to understand that this is not this is going to be good for people in general, and it has to actually be good for general people in general. You know, this can't be a lie. So, last two slides, I'm showing you two extremes of the way that central banks might be involved in this new market-based credit system. One is sort of at a distance, the last resort, so that there's this robust first resort system where the dealers have lots of reserves and lots of capital, and they're rather robust, and the central bank is standing rather far behind and saying, if in the off chance you really got into trouble, you know, we will, and at some price that might be pretty high, we will backstop you. Okay, that's this picture here. Last resort. This is only going to work though in countries where there is a robust first resort financial system, where there's a deep and liquid markets and dealer markets that are making two-way markets. Okay, in more primitive financial system, this is not going to work. So here's the extreme on the other side, where the central bank itself is the dealer, okay, in both of these markets. And this is what that would look like. The central bank is doing the money funding, okay, by expanding its own balance sheet. Okay, is doing the money funding of here that's financing this. I mean, if you consolidate these balance sheets, you can see that this is money funding the expansion of residential mortgage-backed securities. And not only that, okay, it's also making markets in risk. Taking all this risk onto its own balance sheet. I don't think any central bank is going to do quite that far, okay? But this bit here, the foreign exchange swap, okay, maybe central banks are doing. Maybe not explicitly, but implicitly. So this is something to watch. I think most central banks are going to be somewhere in between the spectrum. Here's the extreme on one case, there was the extreme on the other case. Lender of only really, really last resort, okay? That's what the Fed kind of would like to be, okay? And it's hoping that there'll be a robust, and there probably will be, robust infrastructure for dollar-denominated claims at all horizons. For others, that's not going to be so, okay? Okay, and so it's about picking your battles. Where are you going to backstop this system? How much, how far down that road to being first resort are you going to be? And of course, if you are first resort, you're first in line in political terms as well. Becomes much more highly politicized if you're a lender of first resort than a lender of last resort. Okay, this is just collected papers of Perry Maryland recently. These are the links to this online course that I'm teaching right now. Are any of you in this course, or any of this? Some of you. We're doing it for the third time this summer, and I think we're in week 5 right now. Which was my, I'll tell you a secret now. That course came about because of the, because of various other financial crises that were happening. I was in New York, and I said, I'm teaching money banking. I have to be able to stand up in front of these students and say something that's reasonable. I better learn how the system works. Okay. And so after 15 years of doing that and revising those lectures every year, I decided to film it. And so that's what that is. Okay. This is the result of 15 years of intellectual struggle. And I still do. I mean, there's many things that have come after that course. These were filmed in the fall of 2012. All of these things came after. That's why I put that. And this talk does, too. There's nothing in the course about politics. So this is what I'm trying to think about now. I think there needs to be new economic thinking. I think it's starting to happen. The fact that Christine Lagarde says bank solvency, that's not what we should think about anymore. It's market liquidity. That seems to me right. Okay. I said that, I'm going to say, 3 years ago, okay, and nobody listened because they thought they could just smash shadow banking and it would go away. Okay. But it didn't. It didn't happen. It didn't happen. So maybe we lost 3 years, but it's only 3 years, and we can still do something. But I think that our ability to implement, one of the reasons that we focus on bank solvency was because politically it was a lot easier. Okay? You could just say, we know about that because we know about traditional banks, Jimmy Stewart banks, and let's just make these things so that they will never fail. They'll have all this capital. So there was some sense that we don't want to grapple with shadow banking because that's all of this bits of banking that we find very terrifying. The alchemy of this, the global character of it, you know, all of that. Let's focus on the community bank. But community banking is just not that important quantitatively. This stuff is important quantitatively, and this is the stuff that needs to go right if the world system is going to continue to give us growth and prosperity. So that's that. That was an hour.
Thank you.